This session is sponsored by the Caribbean Institute of Medical Science, CARIMER, an affiliate of MPR, which is a global clinical research organization based in the United States that conducts clinical research in over 60 countries of the world. And in Jamaica, we have launched CARIMER some 2 years ago, and headed by Lorenzo Gordon, Operational Manager Director, Shelley McFarlane. We have completed our first third phase clinical trial sponsored by Mass Pharmaceutical, and we are in the business of some other clinical research at hand currently. And this session is on diabetic neuropathy, the clinical syndrome unraveled. And here we're gonna ask our first presenter, Dr. Jeffrey Lombardo, federal certified patient safety organization personnel at the Empire State Patient Safety Network. He's also associate director at the University of Buffalo and research assistant professor at that institute. He's a faculty member at Sony School of Health Institute, as well as professor at the University of Buffalo Medication Management Research Network. He has worked with community oncology clinics, tracking patients' outcome and providing guidance on best clinical practice. And I'll invite Dr. Lombardo to the podium.
Thank you, everyone. Honored to be here. This topic in particular is very interesting to me, as most of my background has been in oncology, and probably 15-20% of the products that I use are natural products. Cannabis is one of interest to me. So we'll get right into the topic. And some of the slides may be repetitive, but I think it's somewhat good review. And if we start looking at the endocannabinoid system, and the discovery of this is over 20 years ago by Raphael Mushulam, has really been the pioneer in this field. The two endogenous cannabinoids, anandamide and 2-AG. And what they do is, I think of it as a regulatory mechanism, very similar to the endocrine system in promoting this homeostasis within the body. In particular, CB1 and CB2 receptors, G-coupled protein receptors, just two of 1,000 receptors that are out there. And I like to remember this as CB1 is more in the brain, and CB2 is more in the peripheral and has an immunological effect and effect on macrophages. So a colleague of mine was found out I was coming down and given the talk, and he sent me this slide, and what is cannabis, what does it do? And if we have any hospital administrators in the room, we can pretty much replace our whole hospital formulary with cannabis, because if you look at the indications and what it treats and what it cures, it really pretty much does everything, or we may think it does. But going back to evidence-based literature and what we know at so far, most of the literature that's been done has been on THC and CBD. And earlier we heard about how THC research has been done in AIDS epidemics for patients with cachexia. And where I've seen the use of THC is in oncology population for those suffering as for an antiemetic for a very aggressive chemotherapy. And some of the problems with Marinol, Dronabinol, that single compound isolate, is it was very difficult to dose patients. And usually these patients, when they're having high degrees of emesis, it was very difficult to titrate. And some of the side effects prohibited the use of that drug. And since then we've come up with some newer agents that seem to work better, 5-HT receptor antagonists and some of the other arsenal. So we move into cannabidiol, and a lot of the talk about cannabidiol is really researched with the work that Josh Stanley has done out in Colorado and the Stanley brothers. And I recall him saying this phrase, is he calls it the hippie's disappointment. And what his family did was he grew a strain of cannabis that was, the THC component was taken out, and it was a high dose CBD concentration. And the hippie's disappointment comes into the fact that, you know, why would you grow a strain that like that and not have any psychoactive effects? But you know, the real reason why is this little girl in the middle, Charlotte Figuier. Those who are unfamiliar with Charlotte's early on suffering from Dravet syndrome, a condition where these childs have hundreds and hundreds of seizures a daily, and you know, the mortality rate is high. They might not even make 10 years of age. So Josh talked about this in the TED Talks, and it was brought up by an individual, Sanjay Gupta, which is a physician you might know from CNN, who picked up that and portrayed the weed series and really kind of started the momentum around cannabidiol. So if we look at the agent in particular and how it's manufactured into the plant, we have oletic acid, and I don't know if we have a pointer here. Okay, and guaiodiphosphate enzymatic reaction moves it to CBGA, which is located right here. And I think of this, we have some differentiation at this point. I think of it as a stem cell. Depending on what enzyme is highly concentrated at that point, it could differentiate into THC, CBG, or the other pathway. But if we look at CBDA synthetase, we actually can produce CBDA, which at this point is a very unstable compound. Naturally, with time, it will convert to CBD, or through thermal conversion by smoking, it can actually convert to that active compound. So if we look at the pharmacodynamics, many cannabinoids that are out there identified in cannabis, and 40% of the plant extract is cannabidiol. A little bit about the receptor affinity. It has a low receptor affinity for CB1 and CB2. Now, what that low affinity means is, think of it as a lock and key. The key goes into the lock, but it can very well be dissociated from that. And usually you need higher concentrations of a low affinity drug in order to have some type of physiological response. And CBD also is an indirect antagonist of those agents. I underline this point here because I think it's very relevant. We talked earlier about drug interactions, and from some of the slides earlier ago, some of the diabetic medications really metabolize by this 2-6 pathway, and we know that cannabidiol can actually inhibit that pathway, and it can actually potentiate the effects of THC. So you really need to do a good med profile, see all the agents that the patient is on, and do an analysis based on that. Some of the clinical implications that some of the literature is out there is neurological conditions, mood disorders, and pain management. Because this title, the talk is with pancreatic islet cells, a little bit about this organ. Here we have a cross-section histology, and within here, the pancreatic islet cells are the islets of Langerhorne, commonly known as a conglomerate of many islet cells, which elicit various endocrine responses. And we look primarily at the beta cell, which encompasses a big portion of this islet cell. Is really the theme of what we're talking about today is directly related to insulin release. So anytime you do a talk, I like to start out with a literature search, that something that I'm maybe not 100% or my field. And so what a lot of people do is they use Google for the literature evaluation search. And if you just search that with cannabidiol and islet cells, you'll automatically come up with over 20,000 hits. But you know, recently Google Scholar came out, which is more evidence-based medications and publications, and it kind of narrows that down to 381. So that kind of gives you a little bit of a reflection of a lot of the information that is out there. And you know, a lot of the information you really need to be critical in how you evaluate it. But this is really more how I like to do literature evaluations. I like to go to the NIH and some of the data houses, and if you look at a study just at cannabidiol, we have 1,501 hits. And if you look at cannabidiol in islet cells in particular, you can see that there's not a lot of literature that are out there. Okay, so if we back up and at the theme of our talk and look at diabetes management, 27, and if we look at human studies, we really only have 14 papers that we can really evaluate. So in the contrast of time, I'm going to talk about two animal studies. And this article right here, Weiss, this is by Weiss and Weiss models, and we heard a little bit about GPR55, which is possibly another CBD3 receptor site, and a very good review of Hurwitz. But if we get into the first trial, we look at Weiss, and this is really what cannabidiol, we think, works well by these anti-inflammatory and immunological effects that it has. And I'm just going to go through the results of the trial, and not so much on the design, but what cannabidiol has thought to do in pancreatic islet cells is reduce these pro-inflammatory cytokines, IL-1, TNF-alpha, and interferon gamma. And it's also been shown to suppress a cell-mediated autoimmune joint dysfunction in rat models that portrayed rheumatoid arthritis. To the pancreatic islet cell in particular, it showed a reduced insulinitis after histology examination. Some of the more the immunological effects, and once again, we have this T1, T helper cell 1, T helper cell 2, which is this homeostasis that occurs and actually shown a in vivo active T cell reduction compared to the Th2 associated cytokine was increased compared to controlled mice. So that is a immunological effect that we see in diabetes, as we see the shift from this Th1 helper cell to a Th2 immune response, which is more favorable in this type of setting. Once again, this is a little bit about CB1 activation, and if we go about this pathway, you have increase of a decrease in glucose tolerance, which shows a promotes the hyperglycemia. You have an increase of reactive oxide species or oxidative stress. When intense causes endothelial damage, what caused to diabetic complications and in a sense, neuropathy as well. And CBD2, which we want to go, actually kind of reverses, and if we look at activation of that pathway, we kind of see a decrease in some of the events that happen. So we look at GPR or G protein receptor 55 and its effect primarily on insulin release. Here you have activation of the cannabinoid, and what you see is conversion of GDP to a GTP state. And we see a conformational change in the receptor, and we see some type of dissociation. And we have a cellular response that occurs at that point. It's either some type of secondary messenger or possibly an ion channel that opens up. And this is a little bit more better depiction, a little bit more complicated, but it shows you the degree and the complexity of these enzymatic reactions. This pathway in particular is a pathway which is RAF-ERK pathway, which has been known to be very influential in the oncology space. And there's actually been some studies in breast models and in glioblastomas that some combinations of cannabidiol may be effective in those conditions, once again, in animal models. But this study in particular looked at insulin secretion and changes in intracellular calcium, and they looked at four arms. They looked at endogenous ligands, they looked at synthetic cannabidiol, they looked at an abnormal cannabidiol analog, and actually an antagonist. And these are the results. It showed that the abnormal cannabidiol actually showed an increased release of insulin release based on a glucose load. And from that interpretation, we can look at these development of these agents that are agonizing of GPR55 receptor proteins may be a potential therapeutic target for patients with type 2 diabetes. And we know that the concentration of GPR55 receptors in the pancreatic beta cells are high. So we heard a little bit about in the United States, this is cannabis and medicinal marijuana, cannabinoid replacement therapy, we're kind of going through a little phase right now. We have 24 states that have legalized cannabis, and four was recreational. And we're having a kind of a difficult time with the system from state to state because it varies quite a bit. And what indications can be treated, the number of licenses that can be obtained within a certain state, quantity limits. Some states will allow a 10-day supply, some a 30-day supply, and the operational, how to maneuver the system, how to register online, and some states will actually give you this card for identification. And the system is a little bit difficult from state to state. So we heard about this conference, which is a very good conference that was done probably 3-4 weeks ago, the NIH conference, Neuroscience Effect, and looked, day one was really kind of the negative effects around brain development in particular for children under 16, and the effect on community when it comes to driving, and you know, public health concerns associated with it. And day two was really focused on more of the therapeutic of potential, pain, anxiety, PTSD, epilepsy, and MS. So we had heard that I think this is gonna be an area for funding and research in the United States as time progresses. And if you look just at today in cannabidiol, we really don't have any current studies in diabetes at this portion, but there are some that have been completed by GW Pharma, but the results really haven't been that encouraging. So at this point, I'm gonna try to give you a little bit of a look ahead and some of the plans of what we want to do, and try to piggyback a little bit on Dr. Morse's talk a little bit this morning, and a little bit of going forward in the future over the next 12 months. But we know, we heard some of these statistics from the Minister of Health, that diabetes is a concern in this area in particular. And this is the, I guess if you look at a curve that compares the NIC region versus the United States, it's kind of more of a downward trend, but you still have an increase, which is greater than the norm here in Jamaica. So proud of this collaboration that we have with the University of West Indies and SUNY. Memorandum of Understanding has been created with the Global Health Alliance and has been ongoing for approximately 3 years. One in particular, a certain subset of that MOU is a program development in diabetes, digestive disease, and liver, really focusing on diagnostic, screening, and treatment for diabetes. So we heard about earlier this week, we were hard at work meeting with some of the leadership, and you know, what are the next steps of doing research here in Jamaica around diabetes and other programs in particular? If you're sure you recognize some of these individuals in the audience, from UE, and we have our punch list to go forward. But in particular, if you look at some of the things that we can do right away is build an infrastructure and capacity for to do clinical research and clinical trials, really establishing that infrastructure, which is critical. Some of the items that you might need to do one type of trial, you know, we focused on the data acquisition, the informatics, research support, and computer IT integration that needs to be developed. And one would think that a protocol could be devised here, looking in type 2 diabetes. For example, we might look at patients for a change in hemoglobin or A1C in 24 weeks. Various secondary outcomes that we can propose and we can do. This could be a randomized trial in type 2 diabetes. We can look at certain combinations that's high in cannabidiol, low in cannabidiol versus placebo. And I think the trick here is, you know, what really are those combinations that work? And are these combinations reproducible from formulation to formulation? Do we have good manufacturing practice where they can be free of all pesticides and follow them accordingly going forward? And if we look at this patient enrollment, you know, we could look at a power calculation. What is gonna be the statistical difference that we see that is somewhat meaningful? Earlier in the week, I've heard that some people in clinics will show up and have a A1C of 22 or 23, and that's not abnormal. So having a decrease would be good. And you know, this patient population, we could look at patients that have diabetes or those without or at different various conditions. I'll kind of close up with the data acquisition and how we can do that. We have a technology which is a smart card technology. Really, you can get a EMR data acquisition on a credit card. We've done that in some studies in the past, and it's an electronic capture of medical information. It could be, I was happy to hear that Jamaica is soon to be going towards a national EMR, being implemented in 23 hospitals and all the clinics over a series of time. I think that's a critical step that is needed in establishing, you know, an aggregate point. So in closing, CBD's effects in diabetes, you know, I think we're on our way. Here we have in Jamaica Observer, we saw the MOU that was signed by the vice chancellors. And you know, cannabis research is obviously the cornerstone of going forward to answer some of those questions. And at that point, I thank you.
Excellent in terms of time. And we have, in fact, 4 minutes. Any question?
As I understand it, you pointed out that the G-protein 55 was its receptor was very important for activating cannabis in diabetics. Is that what you said? Did I get it correctly?
Analogs showed an increase in insulin release. And what they did in that study, they looked at four different formulations. And in rat models, they used different concentrations of diabetes controls, and one certain cannabidiol analog showed an increased insulin release versus the other three formulations.
But I really, and that's good. Thank you very much. My question, though, in that is whether you believe that the that this G protein is the critical protein for insulin release being activated by cannabis, and if so, how sure can you be that this is the case?
So once again, so when you go to rat models and you try to extrapolate that into humans, I think we have a long way to go. Once again, if we look at the slide and we look at the literature that's been published, there's only one or two reports that said that that's been effective. But obviously that is a target, and it was heavily discussed and discussed at the NIH meeting 4 weeks ago. So I think there may be some validity there. We certainly have to go a little bit further in the type of studies that we do, though. But, you know, comparing to some other G proteins, yes. And there's even elicited that there's a CB4 receptor as well. So at what combination, this intricacy of events that occur, but yes, it's encouraging.
Wonderful. We'll move to the second presentation, which is cannabis usage in the context of neurological disease, clinical cases, and a review of the literature by Dr. Amza Ali. Who completed his medical and postgraduate degree at the University of the West Indies, and later pursued postgraduate studies, fellowship, and training in the UK at the National Institute of Neurology and Neurosurgery, and in epilepsy at the Columbia University. Elected as a fellow to the National Academy of Neurology in the US in 2013, he has received many national and international awards, both in neurology and in epilepsy in particular. Currently, he's a consultant neurologist at the Kingston Public Hospital and at the Andrews Memorial Hospital. He's also a visiting professor to the University of Yale. Dr. Ali will speak now. Thank you.
Thank you, Lorenzo. When I was asked to speak on this subject, my focus is obviously on neurological disease, but all clinicians know that neurological disease is often linked etiologically in the Caribbean context to diabetes. Diabetes and neurological disease often go hand in hand, especially in areas of high prevalence such as this country and this region. And so it was very appropriate and apt in a sense that I could speak on neurological issues in the context of a conference that is principally about diabetes in general. But I've also had experience in the context of looking after patients with neurological disease who have used cannabis in various preparations, and I thought it would be worthwhile to tell you some of those cases and to put it in the context of understanding the place and purpose of cannabis and cannabinoids as a therapeutic agent. And so basically what I'm going to do is to present five cases to you and to discuss the use of a very important derivative of cannabis, cannabidiol, for the treatment of epilepsy, and to talk briefly about a study we're doing in which we'd been looking at pregnant women with epilepsy, and we happened to come upon a couple of, some of them, who have also been using cannabis. So these, as I said, are the five cases, and I'll take them one by one and discuss the literature around them. So cannabis, as you know, has a long history. It's been in Jamaica for a long time. There's a long history of social acceptance in Jamaica, even though for much of that time it has been illegal. Various studies have looked at how many people use it and have used it on a regular basis, and that ranges between 10 and 17%. And since 1964, there have been many researchers in Jamaica, some more prominent than others, who have patented derivatives of this agent for the treatment of conditions such as glaucoma, asthma, and hemorrhoids. 16 years ago, I wrote a paper on the benefits to a patient of mine with epilepsy and who had been using cannabis, and unfortunately at the time, it was not accepted. Things have changed a lot since then, and that is a good thing. So what is the context for the cases that I'm going to present? Well, media. The media has been an incredibly powerful agent and is one of the most powerful agents, as we know, nowadays in all aspects of our life. That it has been useful in the treatment of pain and epilepsy has driven people to consider whether or not it could represent a useful agent to them and to those who are suffering with those conditions. Obviously, it's prompted many conversations between them and us as physicians, of patients who want to try it and who have, in fact, started it on their own. Some patients want to try it, but unfortunately, even though you know they might benefit, we don't have it and who standardized forms of the agent.
Some patients want to try it, but in a medicinal form here in Jamaica.
Unfortunately, even though you know they might, and so it's very difficult to endorse using this substance in the Caribbean context. Unfortunately, the slides are showing. And these issues are, of course, the same as elsewhere in North America, where physicians report exactly the same issues. Although, of course, in the US and Canada, they have many standardized formulations. So my first patient I'm going to tell you about is Mr. MR. At the time, a 59-year-old man who had a motor vehicle accident 20 years before, in which he sustained significant head injury with loss of consciousness, occurring in the context of, unfortunately, drinking and driving. He was a heavy, one would say, unrepentant smoker, but never did cannabis. And for the prior 18 years, had been suffering with severe daily cluster headaches. Now, cluster headaches, you would know, are the most severe and serious of headaches. They are called otherwise suicide headaches. These headaches are typically periocular and ocular, associated with running of the eye, blockage of the ipsilateral nasal passages, and an inability of the patient to even lie down or sit down. And many of you would have seen such patients. Some patients have been known to kill themselves because of how bad these headaches are. I have had a patient who ran himself deliberately into a concrete wall to knock himself out because of how bad these headaches are. They are very strongly associated with cigarette smoking, and stopping cigarettes is a very good way of helping to ameliorate the syndrome. But he would not stop. He could not stop. And he tried a wide variety of agents, including under my prescription, gabapentin and pregabalin, which are very potent drugs to modify neurogenically related pain. And it would not stop. And then one day he came to me, and he was smiling. And he said to me, "Doc, I am cured." And I asked him how he was cured. And as you see there, this is what happened. His helper saw him suffering one day and said, "Let me make you some ganja tea." And since then, and it is now 7 years later, this man drinks his cup of ganja tea every morning, and he has been entirely headache-free. And he still continues to smoke. Now, looking at the literature around cluster headaches, it's very interesting that there is a concentration of CB1 receptors in the hypothalamus. And one of the putative mechanistic concepts about cluster headache, which is a very poorly understood syndrome, is that there is the site of pathology may be the ipsilateral posterior hypothalamus, and that its activation may be the reason for these cluster headaches. And so the proximity of these CB1 receptors, which of course are activated by cannabis and in particular THC, must be, would seem to be mechanistically relevant. In a big study by LaRue, in which 139 patients were looked at, almost 50% of these patients had tried cannabis to modify their headache syndrome, of whom 20% reported having tried it during their attacks. Overall, of those who tried it, approximately a quarter of them reported some efficacy, half of them a variable or uncertain effect, and basically the rest did not have benefit. As such, the efficacy of cannabis for cluster headache was deemed to be very likely low. But this obviously has to be corroborated in a controlled clinical trial, which has not yet been completed. But, you know, what do I tell my patient? My patient clearly is not going to come off his agent just because the literature doesn't seem to support its efficacy. The second is... The second patient I'm going to tell you about is a 34-year-old female of mixed ethnicity whose clinical picture was characterized by acute optic neuritis in her left eye, and then in the next year, right optic neuritis. She was seen at the Mayo Clinic in Rochester because she had a family member who was a physician there, and the diagnosis of MS was made. She was started on a disease-modifying agent, i.e. betaferon, which did reduce her overall relapse frequency in that she was followed for some years without any events. But she really had lots of side effects from the agent and so self-discontinued the agent after 4 years. In 2010, she suffered a very severe attack that left her with really bad right-sided spasticity, ipsilateral shoulder dystonia, and an unremitting painful shoulder, which would not respond to any of the usual antispasticity agents nor pain medication. On her own, in desperation, one night when she was really low, she decided to smoke cannabis. She used to smoke sometimes in the past, and she had dramatic relief of her shoulder discomfort. And now she follows a formula in which she does meditation, yoga, massage, clonazepam, and that generally tends to work. But when she has flare-ups of her, especially during times of stress, she will smoke her cannabis. And I can tell you, she normally walks in like this when she's having a bad day, and after she has shown me that she's able to keep her shoulders horizontal and be pain-free. When she smokes. And what this smoking does, it doesn't just help for a day. She breaks the spasm, and she's able to go for a long period of time before needing to smoke again, typically again only when she has another reason for a flare-up, such as stress and so on. So what does the data show on the use of cannabis? In Corey Bloom's study in Canada, in which smoked cannabis was the agent, This data is very instructive. How do you get the pointer on this? Yes. As you can see here, this is a crossover study with a washout period in which patients who are given, patients on a placebo, that's their Ashworth score. Sorry, the Ashworth score is an objective measure of spasticity. And when patients are given, whenever they smoked, their objective score dropped precipitously. And when they crossed over, again, whenever they were exhibited cannabis, their Ashworth score dropped. This is looking at the data in a different way, before and after treatment with cannabis. This is the placebo, and this is the Ashworth score after exhibition of the cannabis. As you can see, there was a functional, objectively demonstrable change in spasticity when cannabis was exhibited as a smoked agent. When all the literature is looked at, what is clear is that when the agent is a combination of THC and CBD, most of the benefit seems to be when there's a combination or an oral cannabis extract used, in which objective as well as subjective evidence of reduced spasticity is demonstrable and exhibited by functional things such as improved 10-meter walking times, and also other measures improve, such as bladder function, tremor, pain, and sleep. This is a complex thing, of course, because when sleep improves, many other things improve as well. But does it really matter? In the end, it's about the functional status of the patient. Of course, it matters from a research point of view and an attempt to define what is the reason for the patient's improvement. But the patients overall, obviously, are benefiting. And much of this data has been corroborated in other studies. What Koppel's systematic review did was to look at all of the data, and it seems that oral cannabis extracts are of greatest benefit, greater benefit than the Bixamol, which is an equal combination of THC, CBD, and then THC. And these measures of benefit are objective as well as subjective in terms of spasticity and also in terms of pain and urinary dysfunction. So clearly, patients who are suffering from many of these very disabling problems are finding benefit. My third patient is a 69-year-old Chinese man who had developed progressive lower back pain, and this evolved to severe radicular pain on walking that was relieved by rest. MRI and EMG confirmed the presence of spinal stenosis with active radiculopathy. He was unresponsive to regular medical management and physiotherapy, and so had surgery. Unfortunately, his surgery, as is often the case, as you know, the dictum is surgery will work 50% of the time, was partially successful, and despite psychotherapy and other attempts to manage him, his pains became again very intractable, and he was essentially a surgical failure. He became very depressed. Chronic radicular pain is a very depressing thing, and he did not respond to a trial of paroxetine, and he too turned to cannabis, initially smoking and then afterwards using the ganja tea, and has had dramatic relief of his symptoms. He's back to playing squash. He's still on his paroxetine, but is continuing to use cannabis in one form or another. What are the clinical considerations in this patient? Well, obviously, cannabis-related drugs are useful in treating depression. And if you lift the mood of a patient, then many of their physical symptomatologies, especially neurological disease, they often improve as well. And so there may be a direct benefit of the agent in terms of treating depression. But one very important thing, and that was alluded to by Dr. Lombardo, is the effect cannabis and THC in particular has on the metabolism of these drugs that utilize the cytochrome P450 enzyme system. And as an inhibitor, this may be increasing the drug level of his paroxetine and therefore improving his depression. It's possible. Now, this has to be looked at in more detail. Of course, a randomized clinical trial is necessary, and that is actually going on right now with a big trial being done at UC San Diego on dronabinol, which is a synthetic THC, and vaporized cannabis, which, as you know, these drugs that heat cannabinoids, as you heard, activate the drug, and the vaporized agent is far safer than using the marijuana leaf. With all its complexities and potential pesticides, as you also heard from Dr. Lombardo. And this will be a very interesting study in terms of seeing what the outcome is. My fourth case is that is the patient whose case history I wrote up 16 years ago and was never able to publish, and now I get a chance to talk about him. He was an 18-year-old man in 1999 who had had a four-year history of recurrent generalized tonic-clonic seizures with no definite aura to suggest a localization-related type of epilepsy. But he also had a long history of cannabis usage and was a very, very aggressive young man. He had been, in fact, expelled from school for his behavior. A neurological examination was entirely normal, although he did have a borderline IQ, perhaps related to his limited education, perhaps related to the chronicity of his smoking, and so on. But his investigations, at the time, all he had was a CT scan of brain, and that was normal. And an EEG demonstrated a possible focus in the left temporal area. At the time, a long time ago, before many of the new anti-epileptic drugs, he was put on phenytoin and urged to stop cannabis usage. He was closely supervised by his mother, and when compliant and off cannabis, he continued to have seizures. In frustration, his mother said, well, just go ahead and smoke. I can't bother with you. But he insisted on him still taking his phenytoin. Guess what? His seizures completely stopped. An EEG was repeated at that time for what it was worth, and there were no epileptiform changes. I want to caution you on that. An EEG is a dynamic study. It does not necessarily mean that it had abolished anything, but it's still interesting to note. And during periods of poor phenytoin compliance, however, he had recurrent seizures. And again, one wonders about what effect the cannabis is having on the drug levels of a drug that is metabolized through the cytochrome P450. But still, here is a situation where a patient, not well controlled, gets control when he smokes, but of course, during periods of poor compliance with his primary anti-epileptic drug, notice I say primary anti-epileptic drug, continues to have seizures. Here I want to stop and talk a little bit, not just because epilepsy is my favorite topic, but because it's relevant. There's been a lot of hype and a lot of publicity about this agent, and it has, in my practice and in my experience, made many patients less compliant with their standard agents, both for pain and for epilepsy treatment, because of a feeling of a need to experiment with what they think is the new wonder drug. And it's led to breakthrough events. And this is really a problem, but you can understand it, particularly in the context of the lower socioeconomic circumstances, where the cost of drugs is very high, and in particular social circumstances, the drug has high social acceptance, and therefore it's very easy to move into using the drug. And it has led to worse seizure control for many patients, therefore. I even had a situation where a patient with a primary generalized epilepsy syndrome, which as you know is an idiopathic epilepsy syndrome and not at all a type of epilepsy that would respond to cannabis, in a patient who was very well controlled on lamotrigine, stopped her lamotrigine abruptly and started using cannabis as a tea, and of course went into status. And this is the consequence of what the media can do. Looking at the literature in more detail, there are many articles on the potential utility of cannabis in the treatment of a wide variety of epilepsies and in a wide variety of ages. What really is very interesting about this is that not only are most patients improving, but it's really the interesting features are in the details. In that study by Kuna, in which 4 of 8 patients on cannabidiol improved, these four patients actually were intractable adults who were potential surgical candidates who actually stopped having seizures and therefore probably have been saved, at least at this point in time, from needing epilepsy surgery. So there's a whole lot in there that is of potential significance. Whether, of course, this agent is going to prove to be enduring in effect in each of these patients, only time will tell. And that is, in fact, exactly the situation that has happened with Charlotte Figi, who, as you know, did dramatically well, in which her seizures were reduced to one or two a week from hundreds a day, but unfortunately her seizures are starting to creep up in frequency as of late. So the question is, what are we trying to aim for? Do we want just a high concentration CBD cannabis agent, or do we want to seek the holy grail, identify the single active component of this cannabis, this amazing plant, that might in fact be the source of all the benefit? Is that agent cannabidiol? It seems to be certainly the agent of interest. And if you look at, and it's similar to the picture that Dr. Lombardo showed, that that there are many, many benefits from this agent. And because of the fact that it does not have THC, of course, many of the side effects that patients who are using this agent have are related to THC. And THC with the developing brain is really not a good thing. There's a risk of psychosis and long-term cognitive function that is a major, major problem. And certainly from a theoretical perspective, cannabidiol would seem to be the agent worth pursuing. As I come to the end of my presentation, I want to just show you the results of the study so far. We've identified two patients out of the 25 patients who were pregnant, who had epilepsy, who were using cannabis. Interestingly, both of these patients were young patients with poor seizure control. Note, poor seizure control, both of whom were suffering from major depression, and one of them was dealing with a chronic pain syndrome, namely migraine. What was not evident from a retrospective review of the charts was the duration of cannabis usage. And clearly that's important. Have these patients been using this agent for a long time? And what were the reasons for these patients using it? We don't know, but it's possible that these patients were using it for pain or depression, or was it just simply chance? We don't know. One big complicator, of course, is, was the diagnosis of epilepsy correct? There's something called psychogenic non-epileptic seizures, which can often be present in people who have depression or psychopathology. And are these people using these agents in the context of something that is not indeed epilepsy, and therefore would not be finding benefit from it when being used as an anti-seizure drug? So there are many more questions that are being raised by this, and clearly we're going to have to look into this in a prospective way, and we'll have to try to identify and interview these patients directly. So in summary, the recent publicity and hype has led many in Jamaica to be less compliant with their standard medication, particularly when used for pain and epilepsy, because of experimentation with various forms of cannabis. And this has led to breakthrough events. But cannabis and its derivatives will eventually find their place in our therapeutic armamentarium, but they must not be viewed right now at all as a replacement for already efficacious agents. Some final considerations. Some but not all patients report feeling better. And how much of this is a placebo effect? And how much of it is related to the THC component, which is, you know, is the psychoactive component? And does it even matter if the patients are feeling better? I end with my last case, which is a 58-year-old man with a 20-year history of diabetes with typical symptoms suggestive of a progressive diabetic neuropathy, who tried gabapentin and on his own, because he couldn't tolerate the gabapentin, used smoked cannabis, and he too was transformed. His life too was transformed. And this was many, many, many years ago. This was 17 years ago that this patient did this. And I'm very interested by a recent study that came out 6 months ago in the Journal of Pain, in which they demonstrated great efficacy from inhaled cannabis in the treatment of painful diabetic neuropathy, with only one problem, being the functional impairment at the higher doses of THC, 4%, which they cautioned could have some impact in the way patients function in complex tasks such as driving. So I'll leave you with a final thought, though. In the developing world, is there anything wrong with using this property of THC, in adults at least, to modulate previously uncontrolled and often disabling symptoms, particularly in a setting where the economic burden of standard medication often leads to suboptimal dosing, in a setting where the plant has had long social acceptance? Thank you.
That was very exciting. I'll just take just about one question in terms of timing. Any question for Dr. Ali? Burning question?
Interesting presentation, Doc. As been mentioned before, there are over 400 different compounds that are present. And throughout the years, the past 10, 15 years, a lot of emphasis has been placed on THC and CBD. What about the other agents that are present there? And by reading, speaking to other persons, it's also dependent on the means of extraction, the temperature that is used, the effects. All of these things need to be taken into consideration in terms of the effectiveness of the use.
Yes, it's a very good question. There is an effect called the entourage effect, in which one of the theories is that these drugs are working synergistically. These agents, namely CBD and THC, are working synergistically with other things that are present in the whole plant, so to speak. And there are many other things in the marijuana plant. There are terpenes, there are flavonoids, and there are other substances, as you know, within it. And how these things are working together really is the mystery. And that is why I alluded to that in my slide on the controversies in epilepsy. Do we want really a high CBD but whole plant extract, or do we want a single substance? Now, the extraction is a very important point as well. How the route of intake, for example, is very important, because there's a first pass effect through the liver. The onset of action of inhaled drugs are far faster than when you take it orally. And the French even say that the posterior is superior, namely if you put it up, that the effect is faster and even better. So yes, there are many important considerations when it comes to how the drug is given, how the agent is extracted, and whether you're using a single agent or essentially the whole plant. Thank you.
Wonderful. Should you have any other questions, Dr. Ali will be available. And then for last presentation, shall we leave the beauty at the end so it smiles with the roses? And this is Dr. Marie Wiliams. And Dr. Marie Wiliams is a graduate from University of the West Indies, where she completed her first degree in medicine and later her postgraduate degree in internal medicine. She has worked in the interest of neurology along with the side of Dr. Ali at the Kingston Public Hospital for the past 10 years. She's also an academic fellow at the Solution for Delivering Center at the University of the West Indies, and an associate lecturer at the Medical Sciences at the University of the West Indies. She's a consultant physician at the noted Kingston Public Hospital, and her interest in neurology. Welcome Dr. Marie Wiliams, who will speak to us on neurological complication of diabetes mellitus pathways and postulations. Dr. Wiliams.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you, Lorenzo, and I would also like to thank the organizing committee of UDOP for inviting me to speak on this topic. I'd like to say that this is the second time I'm presenting at UDOP, and I'm very honored to do so. Thank you. I would like to start by just giving a brief overview of neurological complications in diabetes, a short discussion on evidence and epidemiology of neurological complications in diabetes mellitus, the evidence linking hyperglycemia to neurological complications, some pathways, more basics than interconnections, postulates, and the road to neurological injury and disease, and we'll end with just a summary and a word on cannabis and possible neuromodulation for neurological complications. The key objective of this presentation is to outline pathways linking hyperglycemia and insulin deficiency or insulin resistance to cellular oxidative stress, and then to make the jump from oxidative stress to neuronal injury and dysfunction. So just for a brief overview, complications can be acute or chronic. Acute complications include hypoglycemic or hyperglycemic encephalopathies. And the chronic complications we normally classify as micro or macrovascular. For the purpose of this presentation, we will focus more on diabetic neuropathy. Diabetes can affect all levels of the neuraxis, from the brain to the muscle. Neuropathy, really, the most common form of neuropathy is a distal symmetric polyneuropathy resulting from a length-dependent or dying-back axonopathy primarily involving the distal portions of myelinated and unmyelinated sensory axons. The morphologic abnormality involves the vasa nervosum, the blood supply to the nerve, and this tends to parallel the severity of nerve fiber loss. So this pathway really involves a complex array of metabolic, vascular, and hormonal factors that shift the balance from nerve fiber repair to damage, with a resultant oxidative stress being at the core of many interrelated or divergent mechanisms. There's a brief word on screening. Clinical, laboratory evaluations, and then often because of associated comorbidities of the peripheral neuropathy, many of these patients will require a multidisciplinary practical approach. I won't say more on this because I believe there will be another talk on this later. Just a little bit on the epidemiology. What I've done is just to use studies on micro or macrovascular complications as a surrogate of neurological disease. Peripheral neuropathy is perhaps one of the most common microvascular complications of diabetes. A study done by the U.S. Caribbean Alliance for Health Disparities Research Group in 2015 on disparities in diabetes mellitus among Caribbean populations, a scoping review, noted that Afro-Caribbeans had higher prevalence of diabetes and microvascular complications compared to Africans and Caucasians. The Caribbean estimated prevalence was stated at 9%, and diabetes was responsible for 13.8% of all deaths among adults in the region. Another study done locally, the epidemiology of diabetes in Jamaica and the Caribbean, a historical review by Ferguson et al., pointed out that the diabetes prevalence in Jamaica was approximately 8% for persons 15 to 74 years. Another paper on diabetic foot complications among patients attending a specialist diabetes clinic in Jamaica, prevalence and associated factors, by Ferguson and Wright-Pascoe et al., pointed out that peripheral neuropathy associated with diabetic foot ulcers, peripheral neuropathy was strongly associated with diabetic foot ulcers with an odds ratio of 9.3. And there was an 8.5% prevalence of amputations with men having a 22.2% prevalence. They also pointed out an increased risk of peripheral neuropathy in patients with hypertension and a longer duration of diabetes. Now, the natural history of neuropathy in diabetes, by 25 years of having diabetes, about 50% of patients will have neuropathy. Overall, 50% with diabetes will eventually develop a neuropathy, and some think that that figure is much higher when you take into consideration subclinical neuropathy. So you can imagine that given the high prevalence of neuropathy and given the high prevalence of diabetes, that it does contribute significantly to morbidity and mortality. Okay, so some studies, again, these are large studies that we're very familiar with. This presentation was updated, but I'll take you through. So the United Kingdom prospective diabetes study, this is a fairly old study, looked at newly diagnosed type 2 diabetes placed on intensive or conventional treatment. They found no significant change in neuropathy endpoints at 10 years. However, at 15 years, they did find a change of neuropathy in 31.2 in the intensive group versus 51.7 for the conventional group, with a 60% risk reduction. Just to note as well, the UK PDS was thought to clearly define improvement in outcomes for microvascular disease, but just a small trend towards improvement in outcomes for macrovascular disease. The Diabetes Complications and Control Trial, looking at type 1 diabetics placed on intensive or conventional therapy, most with no advanced complications, found improvement in microvascular and macrovascular outcomes in intensive versus conventional treatment groups. And for diabetic neuropathy, they found a 60 to 70% reduction in risk in the primary prevention cohort. The EDIC, that acronym is failing me right now. Right, but the EDIC was a follow-up on the DCCT. So they took these patients and looked at them just a little longer. And they found that, and all patients were now in the conventional group, they found that their hemoglobin A1Cs approximated each other, both intensive and conventional, but they still found persistent and lasting benefit of diabetic control and a reduction in neuropathic symptoms and signs in patients who were intensively controlled. Okay, so in essence, we know that neurological complications are associated with diabetes and are aggravated by hyperglycemia. Now, in terms of looking at pathways, there are many pathways. There are pathways that I have not looked at in a very long time. So we're just going to go very simply and short and to the point with this. The basic strategy of metabolism involves ATP generation, reducing power to drive cellular reactions, and that is driven mainly by nicotinamide adenine dinucleotide phosphate, and the provision of building blocks or precursors for biosynthesis. And a key component is acetyl-CoA, which is produced from glycolysis, citric acid cycle, and fatty acid oxidation, and many other cellular processes. Insulin and glucose are essential to all three basic strategies. So you can imagine that deficiency or resistance impacts on myriad cellular functions. There is a long, complex path between food ingestion and these basic cellular needs. Insulin, counter-regulatory hormones, glucose, fatty acids, and protein are at the core of interrelated myriad biochemical pathways and hormone, neurotransmitter, receptor interactions, and signaling. So, dysfunction, deficiency of critical mediators, therefore likely will lead to an equally, if not more, complicated path of injury. And in this case, we're trying to prove neuronal injury. So insulin deficiency or resistance with the subsequent relative counter-regulatory hormonal excess shifts metabolism into a catabolic state focused on producing hyperglycemia. Insulin, as we know, normally promotes uptake and storage of glucose and inhibits breakdown of fatty acids and proteins. Counter-regulatory hormones such as glucagon, now in relative excess, given this now insulin deficiency, drives hyperglycemia through protein and fat breakdown, glycogenolysis, and gluconeogenesis. Severe insulin deficiency shifts the primary fuel usage in the cell to fatty acid breakdown and ketogenesis. The metabolic sequelae is an abnormal intra and extracellular milieu that impacts basic cellular strategy and produce uncoupling of normally intricately regulated metabolic processes. Now, one theory or the thinking is that hyperglycemia plus or minus ketogenesis produces a state of energy excess with an increased burden on the electron transport chain. Remember, the electron transport chain is that final cycle that takes in acetyl-CoA and uses nicotinamide adenine dinucleotide and flavin adenine dinucleotide, both of which we get from glycolysis and Krebs and the Krebs cycle, to produce ATP. So it's a very central and final process in energy production. And here we are loading more stuff and putting more pressure on the electron transport chain. Free radical production is a normal process in the electron transport chain. Electrons are passed along electron carriers, finally accepted by oxygen and form superoxide anion. Further oxidation processes can convert superoxide anions to peroxynitrites, which is a very potent oxidant in the cell. And as this goes on, eventually, the antioxidant effects of the cell becomes overwhelmed. And with oxidant stress, you get oxidation of lipids, proteins, nucleic acids, that alter molecular charge, structure, function, with resultant dysfunctional metabolism, signaling, transport, biosynthesis. This cartoon is just trying to summarize some of that to say that hyperglycemia, ketogenesis, producing energy overload leads to a dysfunctional electron transport chain and hence increased free radical formation. Now, what is the link between this increased free radical formation, i.e. oxidative stress, and neuronal injury? Obviously, the mitochondria is at the center of this process. It is the energy factory of the cell. And free radicals, more free radicals begets more free radicals. Age, advanced glycosylation end products, and the receptor for age are involved in glycation of tissue and circulating proteins. And a key product of this is a compound called methylglyoxylate, which is produced from fatty acid oxidation. Now remember, when we get a shift to fatty acid use in the cell, you can imagine that we're going to have increased methylglyoxylate forming, which binds and is bound by glutathione, one of the chief and abundant antioxidants in the cell. So there you go, your glutathione is getting used up, more oxidative stress. Other compounds involved in the pathogenesis and production of this oxidant stress include sorbitol. And sorbitol is a compound that has been well studied because of the possible implications in the treatment of diabetic neuropathy. They have found interesting results from mouse models for sorbitol. However, human clinical trials of the rate-limiting enzyme in sorbitol metabolism, which is aldose reductase, and the use of aldose reductase inhibitors have not proven to be as beneficial. Hexosamine is another source of oxidant stress, protein kinase C. This is actually PARP, or poly-ADP ribose polymerase, which is activated by hyperglycemia. And PARP can in turn increase protein kinase C production. So apart from the oxidant stress, there are also vascular and prothrombotic events. And they have shown that there are thickened endoneural blood vessels and vascular occlusions on autopsy reports of diabetics with neuropathy. They've proven as well that there's reduced oxygen tension within diabetic nerves. Prothrombotic factors include thrombomodulin and tissue plasminogen activator, which when reduced drive neuropathy. Very importantly as well, nerve growth factors, and there are several of these: brain-derived neurotrophic factor, neurotrophin 3, insulin-like growth factors. Interestingly, one experiment proved that insulin itself may function as a growth factor, a neurotrophic growth factor to peripheral neurons. And of course, what we're all familiar with clinically, the metabolic syndrome, which often accompanies type 2 diabetes mellitus. Recall that many of these studies show a direct correlation with other risk factors such as hypertension, dyslipidemia in producing neuropathy. So the comorbid factors are important in the genesis of neuropathy as well. So free radicals impact mitochondrial function. Mitochondrial failure or dysfunction can lead to energy failure with failure of the sodium-potassium ATPase pump. Now remember, the sodium-potassium ATPase pump acts to drive potassium out and sodium in. So inward sodium movement drives the membrane potential closer to the equilibrium potential for sodium, and hence towards depolarization. Okay, so if you don't have the pump actively pumping out the sodium, it gradually comes in and goes towards depolarization. And this state where the cell is now more primed It's not so hard to stimulate it anymore. It's called increased excitability, and it means that there's a lower threshold for action potential generation and propagation. In addition to this, they found that there is increased glutamate, which is an excitatory amino acid neurotransmitter in the CNS, and they found that in diabetics, you can have impaired reuptake of glutamate from the synapse into the presynaptic cell. So you have a cell that's primed to get stimulated, and you have increased neurotransmitters in the synapse. So it's gonna get excited. So increased glutaminergic excitatory activity opens voltage-sensitive calcium channels. The calcium is kept out of the cell normally, or it's kept sequestered in the cell, in the organelles, endoplasmic reticulum of the cell. And it's done, the cell has to sequester and keep out calcium because calcium is a potent driver of neuronal apoptosis and necrosis. So in necrosis, calcium activates nitric oxide synthase, promotes formation of peroxynitrite and other free radicals. This causes oxidative damage to macromolecules, including DNA, with impaired transcription, translation, and activation of PARP. Critical to the activation and in terms of a final pathway for necrotic cell death is activation of a permeability transition pore in the mitochondrial membrane. So mitochondria is being attacked, you are gonna get energy failure, decreased ATP production, and that's gonna drive more free radicals for cell death. Apoptosis, on the other hand, usually results from a milder injury. And in this case, calcium stimulates enzymes, such as apoptosis-inducing factor, to produce cell death. So in summary, energy and mitochondrial failure leads to loss of ATP from the electron transport chain failure, or other factors, ischemia, hypoxia, and results in the formation of free radicals. Excitotoxicity, resulting from failure of the sodium-potassium ATPase pump, coupled with more synaptic glutamate. All of this, so glutamate is gonna stimulate the voltage-sensitive calcium channels, more calcium is gonna come in, and you know what will happen, neuronal injury and death, and more free radical production to drive the cycle over again. This slide is basically summarizing that. So in summary, I hope I have shown, despite the typos, forgive me, there was an updated presentation, that hyperglycemia leads to oxidative stress, which leads to neuronal injury. Oxidative stress is a common pathogenetic pathway that can be targeted for prevention and treatment of neurological complications of diabetes. A final word on cannabis. The endocannabinoid receptor system involving glutaminergic and GABAergic postsynaptic signaling can result in neuromodulation and possibly suppression of excitotoxicity that leads to neuronal injury and death. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you, Dr. Wiliams. And we shall thank our panel of distinguished lecturers. And I hope you enjoy this presentation.